Good morning. How are you? Amen. Here comes the preacher. All right. Brother Scott's not going to be here with us today, so if you would, we'll go ahead and stand. We'll get started with our service.
Declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh, and these are the days your servant David rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Salvation comes.
There is no God like Jehovah. 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 There is no God like Jehovah.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call.
An enjoyable day in the house of the Lord. Thank you, team, for your presentation and leading us today in our music. As he mentioned earlier, Brother Scott is out of town this weekend, and we're grateful for your being present with us as we've come to worship and to serve the Lord together. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and your kindness and your goodness to each of us, Lord. We've just been through a season of thanksgiving, and Lord, indeed we are grateful for every gift, because we know that every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there's neither variableness nor shadow of turning. And Lord, I know that the best and most wonderful and greatest gift of all was the giving of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came from heaven to this old sin-cursed earth, who lived a perfect life, who died in our place on the cross of Calvary, was buried in a borrowed tomb, but the tomb couldn't hold him. And we know that our Lord Jesus Christ arose the third day, victorious, triumphant over death. And God, we are grateful that the price of our redemption and our salvation has not only been paid for, but the power of that redemption has been demonstrated by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, if there's anybody here today that does not know the Lord as their Savior, may this be the day, the time, and the hour when they come to a full recognition of their sinful condition, and may they come from their unbelief to believe in Jesus Christ and receive Him into their heart, find forgiveness of their sins, salvation of their soul. May they be obedient to Him, Lord, to follow Him in the pathway of life. Father, just take us and use us, we pray, this day in this service. We continue to pray for our military and those who serve in defense of the freedoms that we enjoy today. We pray, God, you'll bless our military families wherever they are. Keep this nation safe, Lord. Our dependence is upon you. Father, just take us and use us today. Forgive us of our sins. Help us to be more like Jesus every day that we live. And we'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory for everything. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated for just a moment. Let me get the necessary announcements out of the way this morning. Most of the announcements have either been on the screen and they are in the bulletin. However, let me emphasize that we have got our current kids spotlight. Today is Ivy Villafor, and a beautiful picture in an insert in the bulletin. And in our youth spotlight today, Aniston Pruitt. And again, her picture is in the beautiful pictures in the bulletin today. We appreciate our children and we appreciate our young people of our church. There's a great emphasis on supporting the kids. And in fact, tonight there will be a children's worship at 6 o'clock this evening downstairs. And they have their own little worship center in the basement. And we have a great emphasis on our children's department as well as our youth department. Going to be a busy day. Going to be a busy day for Corinth today. We got a group leaving for the soup kitchen in Jackson. And as of right now, it's going to be a small team unless some of you want to get on the bus and go with them. So if you don't have plans for this afternoon and you would like to go and serve in the soup kitchen, we have two people right now signed up. So it's going to be a, you know, we need some volunteers. Sometimes I just call names and volunteer you, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to give you the opportunity to sure enough volunteer today. So after the service is over, the bus will be fired up and ready to go, and all you got to do is just volunteer to get on the bus to go and help in the soup kitchen in Jackson, Tennessee, and your volunteering will be greatly appreciated. This afternoon at 2 p.m., Westwood Nursing Center in Decaturville. Pray for us as we go and minister to their needs and worship with them this afternoon. And then at 4 o'clock, we have the children's practice and choir practice. Is that 4? Or we have it choir practice? 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock choir practice this afternoon. Deacons meeting at 5, 6 o'clock sanctuary worship, adult worship here in the sanctuary, and the children's department is having their worship as well. On Wednesday evening, we have a 1 at 6, youth at 6. 7 o'clock business meeting and Bible study here in the sanctuary. So we got a busy afternoon and a busy week ahead. And a great time in the Lord this morning. And we're glad that you're here. Welcome to Corinth this morning.
All right, if you would, we'll go ahead and stand back and we'll continue with our song service.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my
All right, we're going to do a little switching up here. I remember back when I was growing up, me and my mom, dad, and my sisters all sang in a little gospel group. And during the middle of the program, we'd usually swap my two sisters. Some of them do one song, one of them some do the other. They'd always refer to it as switching mules. So I guess we're switching mules this morning. So.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall shall be on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest in the sweet. Shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Shall meet on that beautiful shore.
I guess I should introduce him. This is Mr. Jerry Cox. This is Amy's dad. So, thank you, Jerry.
Well, we've had a good time already in the house of the Lord today, right? We've had such a good time. My ushers are forgetting to come forward, so come right on. Hey, we don't have a schedule today. We're just letting it happen as it happens today. Amen. Brother Jeff Butler, lead us in our offertory prayer, please, sir.
Father God, we've been blessed by the Lord. Father, we just lift you up at this time, Father. And just thank you for this opportunity to gather together, Father.
Yes.
Study your word, hear your word, and Father, just follow your word. Yes. May today be the first day of this week that we have church, and may each day of this week be a church day for us, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Father, be with us as the ones that are in Belize and the ones that are fixing to go and all the many mission endeavors we're about to go with, Father. Just lead, guide, direct in everything that we do. Bless this offering of your kingdom. So pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All righty.
Amazing grace, how sweet a sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Is welcomed home, the sinner now a saint. For the God who died came back to life, and everything is changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? For the mighty King of Kings has disarmed you. Delivered and redeemed, eternal life resounds. Oh, praise his name forever. See your scars, your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I'll lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah! Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? King of Kings has disarmed you, delivered and redeemed, eternal life resounds. Oh, praise his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. On the day you call me in to heaven's sweet embrace, I'll see your scars, your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy I'll lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah! Christ is risen from the grave.
We have something to be thankful for. We have a Savior, Christ Jesus our Lord, and He is indeed risen from the dead. And what a difference He's made in our lives. I just handed an announcement to remind you all, even though it's in the bulletin, the children's Christmas program will be next Sunday night at 6 p.m. And you don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss it. Give me a sad, you're really going to miss a blessing. These kids have been working hard. And they're all excited. We're all excited. 6 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. I'm glad you handed me that note because I'd forgot something. Marla is in, we have a team of one on Operation Christmas Blessing, and she is in Belize this morning, and already the money has been delivered to renew the license for the radio station, so the Voice of the Caribbean will be on the air again for another year, and they're going to be going into the schools of Belize, Central America, sharing with them the good news of the birth of Jesus Christ, and carrying some Christmas presents into the schools, and among them will be an apple and a Bible. And they don't raise apples in Belize. They got a lot of tropical fruit, but they don't raise apples. And so it's a real treat for them to have apples imported in from Mexico into Belize and distributed in the school. But as rare as it is, and as much as they look forward to tasting a sweet, wonderful apple for the first time, the one gift above all gifts that they'll receive is they'll receive a copy of God's Word. And their names will be imprinted on the front of those Bibles. And I've seen the children in Belize, when they receive their Christmas presents from Operation Christmas Blessing, push everything else aside, and they look at that Bible and dive into the Word of God. Isn't it amazing? How precious, how wonderful. And you're going to be a part of it because of your sponsorship of that ministry in Central America. Got your Bibles? I want you to get them, please, and turn me to the Gospel according to St. John, chapter number 7. Chapter number 7. While you're finding your places, and again, I want to express appreciation for the enjoyable music that we had. Corinth is different. We do things all time different, and it's just a blessed, wonderful, and a blessed place to come and worship the Lord, our Savior. But I'm going to try to transition between Thanksgiving and today's service, okay? So I got a few remarks. We are about to finish up the Feast of Thanksgiving at our house, okay? I know what you're thinking. You're thinking Thanksgiving is not a feast celebration. It's not one of those biblical celebrations. You're exactly right. It's not. It is a holiday. One time a year, the last Thursday of November in the United States of America, when we do what the Bible teaches us to do, and that is to be thankful to God and to parents and to family and to friends and to nation, and on the list goes for all the many and wonderful blessings that we're enjoying every single day of our life. But I call it a feast, and we're continuing about to separate us. About to finish up the feast of celebration of Thanksgiving in our house. And I mean by that, we have a tradition at our house. I know most of you think your wife doesn't cook as good as your mother did. I married a lady who can cook. I'm telling you, she can make chicken and dressing as good as my mother did. That's something to celebrate. In fact, before I ever proposed to Miss Rebecca, I asked her, can you cook? Well, actually, I was more specific. I said, can you cook biscuits? And she said, yes. I said, will you marry me? And she could cook biscuits. But what she didn't tell me was they was about that tall and about, well, I'm not going to tell you, they're hard as a rock. But anyway, we got married, and the first morning meal or two was a little bit disappointed. But I said something to my mama, or her mama, one, and they trained her to make the best biscuits in all the world. But I'm telling you. But anyway, we've had chicken and dressing and world famous, better than anybody's, chicken and dressing. And we've been feasting on it ever since Thursday. And with any good luck, we will finish up today after church with a feast of Thanksgiving. So while it's not a biblical feast, it has been a feast time at our house. But I want you to go immediately with Jesus. Go with me and with Jesus. They didn't have that wrote down. But anyway, let's go with Jesus. I got it right. Let us go with Jesus in John chapter 17 to a real Jewish feast. The real Jewish feast. It is the Feast of Tabernacles. And we're going to read about it, and then I'm going to tell you why I am really so thankful that we're saved by grace through faith, plus nothing, minus nothing, and that we don't have to do all the complicated things that the Jews of the Old Testament had to do and the Jews of Jesus' day continued to do. So let's look at it if we may. John chapter 7. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry, because the Jews sought to kill him. They wanted to kill Jesus. You see, he went about doing good. He even went about doing good on the Sabbath day, and they certainly didn't like that. And they were doing everything they could to kill Jesus. Now look at verse 2. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacle was at hand. And his brethren therefore said unto him, Depart hence and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the works that thou doest. You never get too old to learn something from the Bible. Bible is an amazing book. The more you study, the more you want to study. The more you learn there, the more there is to be learned. You never reach that pinnacle, dear friend. We reach for perfection and we'll get it when we step out on the other side. Until then, we're just pilgrims and strangers in this old world, seeking for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. I've learned something. Never too old, 75 years of age, been preaching the gospel since 1958. I've learned something new. I've read this text so many times, and I said Jesus had his disciples with him, and he told his disciples to go on up into Jerusalem to the temple for the Feast of Tabernacles, and I'll be along in a little while. But that's not what the Bible says. It's important not only to know what the Bible says, sometimes it's important to understand what the Bible does not say. In this verse, look at it again, the third verse of John chapter 7. It is now time for the Feast of Tabernacles. It was at hand, it was nearby. And his brethren therefore said unto him, who are the brethren of Jesus? I hit that verse and I said, now, these brethren said to him, let your disciples go on up. So it's not the disciples who are the brethren. You know who the brethren of Jesus are? Did you know that the Bible records that Jesus had four half-brothers and some sisters? Did you know that? He's got four half-brothers that are mentioned in Matthew 13:55, and their names are James and Joseph and Simon and Judas. And at this period in time, they are not believers. Look at verse 5. For neither did his brethren believe in him. They are not believers in Jesus Christ, but they had been observing what their half-brother had been doing, and they saw the crowd and the interest, and that's why they're encouraging him to go up to Jerusalem for the Feast of the Tabernacle. Now, we do know of those four brothers of Jesus that later on they become believers because James writes the book of James, the little epistle of James. And Judas is better known as the book of Jude, next to the last book in the New Testament, the little book of Jude. So Jesus is coming out of the Galilee, headed up towards Jerusalem. It's time for the Feast of the Tabernacles, and his family encounter, his family meeting. They're encouraging him to go up and go for the Feast of Tabernacles on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. Now let's go to verse 6. Then Jesus said unto them, My time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. What did Jesus mean, my time is not yet come? Remember how we started off this chapter? And then saying Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry because the Jews sought to kill him. His time for being arrested and his time for being on trial and his time to be crucified is not at hand. But their time to believe in him is always, it's always the right time to do the right thing and to believe in Jesus and receive him and recognize him as your Savior and your Lord. And so Jesus was appealing unto them, my time is not yet come. I can't go openly up to the celebration in the temple of Jerusalem, but you can go. Verse 7, the world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testify of it, that the works thereof are evil. Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. And when he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee. But look at verse 10. But when his brothers, hey, brothers, I've marked that in my Bible. I don't know if you mark in your Bible or not. I mark in my Bible. I've heard some preachers say there's not a mark in my Bible. I'm glad that God gave you a photostatic memory and you can remember everything. I can't do that. I'm just responsible, and so are you, for the gifts that God has given you. I'm not responsible for anybody else's gift, and neither am I responsible for anybody else's sin. Thank goodness. Because I got enough of my own, you know what I mean? And I need the Lord's forgiveness on a daily basis in my life. But when the brethren, his half-brothers, were gone up, verse 10, then went Jesus also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. He slips in the middle of the feast. Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, where is he? And there was much murmuring among the people concerning Jesus, for some said, he's a good man. Others said, nay, but he deceived the people. Howbeit, no man spake openly of him for fear of the Jews. Now about the midst, verse 14, about the midst of the feast. Now that feast is recorded in Numbers 29, and we're not going to take the time to go to Numbers 29 and read all about the feast. But Jesus evidently shows up in the midst of this feast. This feast was a feast of 7 days celebration with a day of convocation on the 8th day, a great gathering together of the nation of Israel. And that's going to figure into what I'm fixing to say here in just a minute. So what had been happening when the brothers of Jesus had gone up to Jerusalem for the Feast of the Tabernacle? According to Numbers chapter 29, it was on the 15th day of the 7th month. They were to do no work. They were to keep the feast for 7 days. They were offered a burnt offering, a sacrifice made by fire of a sweet savior unto the Lord. They also had an offering that they poured out on that great day of the high feast, the great day of this feast. And during that time, here's what they offered up. I found this interesting, being a farmer, okay, preacher and a farmer. On the first day of this Feast of Tabernacle, they offered up 13 young bullocks, 2 rams, 4 lambs of the first year without spot and without blemish, and 1 kid goat. On the second day, 12 young bullocks, 12, 2 rams, 14 lambs, and 1 kid goat. On the third day, 11 young bullocks, 2 rams, 14 lambs of the first year without a blemish, and 1 kid goat. On the fourth day, they offered up 10 young bullocks, 2 rams, 14 lambs of the first year, 1 kid goat. And Jesus shows up right in the midst of it all, and he speaks and rises to speak the words of my text, if I get to it in a minute, on the last day of the feast. And by that time, they had sacrificed 71 young bullocks, 15 rams, 105 rams of that blemish of the first year, and 8 goats for a sin offering. Boy, I'm glad we are saved by grace through faith, aren't you? I don't know if I can keep up with all that or not. I'm telling you, it was a Jewish guide in the land of Israel that said to me, you guys are not, you know, you're not Jewish enough to really understand your Bible. And I agree with her 100%. Now, I really am not. I'm glad Jesus kept the law and kept the law to absolute perfection, dear friend. And I'm grateful that we're redeemed by the precious blood of the Lamb of God without spot and without blemish. And I'll get back to that in a minute. But right now, Jesus has showed up right in the middle of this Feast of the Tabernacles. And all the sacrificing and all the rejoicing and all the poured out offerings have been made. And Jesus shows up in the middle of it in the 14th verse of the chapter. John 7:14, now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up to the temple and he taught. And the Jews marveled. Here shows this stranger, and they're not sure who this stranger is. Some say that he is the carpenter's son, but he's an uneducated man. He has never sat in the rabbinical school. He was not taught by Gamaliel. Saul was taught by Gamaliel. Jesus was the perfect son. He was a perfect child in Nazareth. If he ever went to school, there is no record of it. And yet he speaks right in the midst of this great ceremony. And the Jews marvel, verse 15, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? They were not the first folks that were amazed at the understanding of Jesus. Remember when he was a 12-year-old boy, he went with his parents up to the temple in Jerusalem. And they ran off and left him. And they came back, and on the third day, what did they find? The 12-year-old boy Jesus sitting at the feet of the doctors of the law. He's asking them questions that they could not answer. And he's answering the questions that they're asking that nobody had ever dared to answer before. And the Bible says that they were astonished at his understanding and his answers. I'm not. You know why? Because he directed the writing of the book, dear friend. Oh, what a wonderful Savior we have. And so he's up in the middle of this Feast of the Tabernacle, and Jesus rises up and he begins to speak to them. And some of them says, you have a devil. And he said, no, I'm of my Father. My Father has sent me on a mission into this old world. So Jesus, in the verse 14th verse, he's up in the middle of the temple and he's teaching them, and the Jews marveled. But the Pharisees are mad. They're mad. Look over to the 31st verse of the chapter. And many of the people believed on Jesus and said, when Christ cometh, will he do more miracles than these which this man hath done? And when the Pharisees heard that the people murmured such things concerning him, and the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him. They called the temple guard. They said, we got an assignment for you. We got a guy who's busting up our Feast of Tabernacles, rising up and speaking, and people are following him. They said, we got to do something about it. They did not understand that the time for Jesus to die had not yet come. Jesus knew all things. He knows the end from the beginning. And he knows fills in the middle too, dear friends. He's Alpha and Omega and everything in between. They said, we got to take this man. We got to stop this fella. He's here teaching in the midst of our great feast and our great celebration. So they sent the elite officers of the temple guard, and they wanted him to arrest him and bring Jesus back to them. Look at verse 33, and when Jesus said it, and then said Jesus unto them, yet a little while, and I am with you, and then I go unto him that sent me. Ye shall seek me, and shall not find me, and where I am, thither ye cannot come. And I can see that temple guard with their assignment of arresting Jesus, and here they go, and they listen to him, and Jesus tells them, I'm going somewhere that you can't come. And interest is aroused. There's coming a day when you're going to seek me and shall not find me. And whither I go, you cannot come. Remember his resurrection from the dead? Huh? When Jesus was raised from the dead, he was only seen by loving eyes and touched by loving hands. That didn't mean the Roman Empire was not putting on a capital search for the man who had been crucified, buried in a borrowed tomb, and they were preaching that was alive forevermore. And for 40 days they'd been trying to get their hands on him, and they couldn't get him, and now that he's absolutely and teetotally disappeared. The temple guards stood there with their mouths wide open. They didn't grab him. They couldn't grab him. Verse 35, then said the Jews among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? We go into the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles. What manner of saying is this, that he said, ye shall seek me and shall not find me? And whither I go, ye cannot come. Now look at the last day, the eighth day, in the last day. Feast had been going on for 7 days. Now it's a day of convocation. A seven-day feast plus a great day of convocation. After all, the nation of Israel had been established as a priestly nation. And had they not rejected their Messiah, they would be carrying the message of salvation, and we might be living in the millennium today. So on the great day of the feast, the last day, verse 37, in the last day, that great day of the feast, the holy convocation. Oh, by the way, they'd been bringing drink offerings all week long. They'd go down to the pool of Siloam, and the priest in the midst of all this would go down there and bring water up. And then pour the water out as a drink offering. And I learned this. Listen to J. Vernon McGee. On that eighth day, the day of convocation, they didn't go with temple utilities. With jars dedicated to the worship of the Most High God. They just didn't go with them and bring back a little water. On the last day, the eighth day, the day of the convocation, they literally went down to the pool of Siloam with barrels. And in the midst of their last day, their final day of celebration, they would lift those barrels and pour them out on the Temple Mount. In the midst of the crowd, so much so that he believes, J. Vernon McGee said he believes that when Jesus utters the next words, he might have been standing ankle deep in water. But Jesus stands up on the final day, the eighth day, the day of the convocation. Amidst the water that was being poured out from the pool of Siloam, and Jesus makes one great invitation statement in the 37th verse. Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, capital S. This spake he of the Spirit, which they that believed on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given because that Jesus was not yet glorified. Did you hear the invitation? Jesus cried, saying, if any man asks you today, are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty? You've been drinking out of the sewer in the cesspools of the world. Come and drink of Jesus. He is the living water. The Jews were big on the waters of symbolism. Jesus is the water of life. I didn't mean to do this, but I'm going to do it anyhow. One of the greatest examples of somebody who drank of Jesus and what a difference it made was in John chapter 4. Remember that Samaritan woman outside the city of Sychar who came early in the morning with pitchers on her head to draw some water for the day. And Jesus sat alone on the curbing of Jacob's well. And he looked at her and said, give me to drink. And she said, how is it that thou, a man of the Jews, just ask to drink of me, a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Boy, she was thirsty. Because in the text of the conversation between this woman and Jesus, she was a sinful woman. She had five husbands and been married five times and was living with a man she wasn't even married to, man. This lady had been around. But she had an encounter with Jesus on Jacob's well, brother. And when she realized that Jesus Christ was the promised Messiah, she said, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called the Christ. And when he's come, he's going to tell us all things. And Jesus said, I that speak to thee am he. And upon this came his disciples and marveled. But she had tasted of the living water, and what a difference it made. You know why? Because John chapter 4 says that she left her water pots and went in the city and told the men, come see a man who has told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And the first cousin, well, actually they were, the Samaritans were half Jewish and half of the nation of Assyria when the Assyrian Empire had conquered the 10 northern tribes of Israel. They intermarried with the Jews, and there's where the Samaritans came from. And Jews had no dealings with them, but Jesus did. You know why? Because he loves everybody. And when she got through witnessing in the city to the men, there was a great revival in that city. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the source of living water. So here in the text, in 37 verse, Jesus invited, if a man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Spirit which they had that believed on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. On the day of Pentecost, the full outpouring of the Holy Spirit came. Every man heard the gospel in his own language where he was born. Parthians, Medes, Elamites, Dwellers, Mesopotamians, Cappadocia, and on the list goes. Every man heard him in his own language. And from that day forward, the Holy Spirit indwells every believer, and we are baptized by the Holy Spirit the moment that we get saved. The moment we come to Jesus, 2 Corinthians, it tells us, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into the body of Christ. Isn't that great? 1 Corinthians 12:13. Isn't that great? Now remember, there was a temple security guard that had been given the orders to go and arrest Jesus, and they're listening to all this. They're watching. They're watching the priest pour the water out for the drink offering. They're hearing Jesus' invitation. He that thirsts, let me come drink. He that believeth on me, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now look at the immediate response of some of the crowd. Verse 40. Many of the people therefore, when they heard this saying, said of a truth, this is the prophet. Others said, this is the Christ. Some said, shall Christ come out of Galilee? Hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh of the seed of David and of the town of Bethlehem where David was? So there was a division among the people because of Jesus. And some of them would have taken him, but no man laid hands on him. And the officers had done everything they could do. And they came back. And they make one of the greatest compliments regarding Jesus. Remember what they said? Verse 45, then came the officer of the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they said unto them, why have ye not brought him? They said, you come empty-handed. Why did you bring Jesus? You were charged with the responsibility of arresting this Jesus of Nazareth. Listen to the answer. The officers answered, never man spake like this man. They had never heard anybody like Jesus. They had never met anybody like Jesus. After all, Jesus invited sinners to come and drink of the fountains of the water of life freely. The Samaritan woman met him at Jacob's well, and what a change, what a difference it made in her life. If I had time, I'd do what I intended to do, and that's give you the life-changing statements of the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Got time to do that. That'll be another Sunday. That sounds like a good idea to me. After all, I'd rather hear two short sermons than one real long one, right? Y'all agree with me on that? I want to give you revelation. Well, we do know some things about the voice of Jesus. The Bible tells us in the book of John that it's a welcome voice like the voice of a bridegroom. In John chapter 10, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and they know it." You know when the Lord's speaking to your heart. He doesn't speak to your ears. He will one of these days. He's coming in the clouds of glory with a shout and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ are going to rise first. And we're going to rise up to meet him in the air, brother. He's going to give a commanding shout that brings the dead from their graves and the living saints up in the clouds of glory for the greatest reunion that we've ever experienced in all of our life. I'd like to know what the voice of Jesus... Don't you wish you could have recorded his voice? He came in the fullness of time, which was not in the electronic age. Because we'd have folks telling us what he said after he said it, when we heard it plain, and they didn't tell us after he said it what he said. They told us something they want us to hear. That's news reporting in our day, but that's a different story. God did it right. It was God's timing. It was God's timing. In the Revelation Revelation chapter 1, he talks about it. He heard his voice as the sound of the trumpet. John the Revelator heard the resurrected voice of Jesus on the Isle of Patmos in the Lord's day, like the sound of a trumpet. Doesn't surprise me. On the Mount of Beatitudes, there were great crowds gathered, and every man heard him clearly. And then he says it's like the voice of many waters in Revelation. But the one impresses me most is Revelation 3 and verse 20. Revelation 3, verse 20. We're going to put it on the board. "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." Jesus said this. If you got a red letter edition of the Bible, it'll be in red. "And behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man," you know, that includes you and me, all of us. That's why there's all those whosoever's in the Bible. We used to sing as a kid, "Whosoever surely meeteth me, surely meeteth me, whosoever surely meeteth me. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man," nobody's left out. "If any man hear my voice and open the door," that's faith, "I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me." There may be some folks here today who's never given their heart to Jesus, and you wonder what in the world's going on in this service. I remember when I was a young man, lost in a revival meeting. I first thought it was a bad case of indigestion. I really didn't know what was going on in my life. And then I came to realize that the Lord was knocking on my heart's door. And I'm so glad that I responded by faith and claimed God's gift of salvation through his Son, Jesus Christ. Followed him obediently in believer's baptism at Eagle Creek. That was a long time ago. It was good then, but it's a whole lot better today. That can be your experience. If you're here this morning and you're thirsty, drink of the fountains of water of life freely. The invitation has clearly been given. It's time for you to respond. Let's pray. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we pray that if there's a man, a woman, or a boy or girl here, Lord, we're all just sinners. But there's some of us that have been forgiven. We're sinners saved by grace. And Lord, there may be some other folks here that are just sinners, but they've never called on the Lord. They've never obeyed him. They've never been attentive to his voice. May they understand that today, through the Holy Spirit that was promised in the 7th chapter of John's Gospel, that Holy Spirit comes to knock on hearts' doors. God, I pray that we'll hear the voice of the Lord today. And if there's a spiritual need in our life, Lord, I pray that this will be the day of response, of repentance, and of faith. May some poor lost soul get saved today, Lord. May some thirsty soul drink of the fountains of the water of life. Lord, if there's some saved folks here today, They know one day heaven's going to be their home. They're looking forward to it, but they're looking for an earthly home. A congregation of believers that study the Bible, preaches the Bible, practices the Bible. Lord, if they're looking for a church of meaningful fellowship and Christian service, may they come and join with us, literally, as we reach around the world with the good news of God's love for every man. So Lord, very simply, we pray, may the lost get saved and saved folks get revived and on fire and down to business serving Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And together we're going to sing a good hymn. 132. Good hymn of invitation. God moves upon your heart. There's a reason. There's a need to respond today. Will you do it? Will you do it? And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilt and stain. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? Isn't that great? Maybe there's a burden on your heart. The altar is always open. Something you want to pray about. Something you need to talk to Jesus about. If you're lost, follow these good saints of God down the aisle and down to the altar. Come on, let's do business with Jesus today, will you? Will you? Sing another verse. God moves upon your heart. There's a reason. There's a need to respond. Come today. Come today. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. When the band was warming up before the service, I was back shaking hands with folks back here, and somebody asked me, they said, are you going to do some mountain preaching? It sounded like we're having mountain music. And I said, amen, brother, because I spent 4 years in the mountains of East Tennessee, and I enjoyed the mountain music immensely. And there was an experience I had in the mountains of East Tennessee where there was a mom and a little girl that came back one Sunday evening, came down the aisle, and said, on the way home, my daughter told me that if that preacher had sung one more verse, I was going to respond. And you cut the song service short. They had prayed that afternoon. She'd invited Jesus into her heart, so they had come forward on Sunday evening to make that publicly known and to unite with the church and Father, Lord, and baptism. And I've thought about that a lot. What if I'd let them sing one more verse? Let's sing one more verse. Just, this has got your name on it. Then we're going to go. Okay? This is that one more mountain verse, okay? Saved to sin no more. Will you come today? Will you come today? I'm going to keep my word. You're dismissed. See you tonight. Amen. God bless you. Don't forget, next Sunday evening, the children's Christmas program.